Well, we are still traveling. This time we come from Kansas, and we took a different highway than we usually took. And at this time, Kenny's time was still limited, so we didn't have much time, but we stopped at Keith Rogers. He had seen them for quite a while, and the kids were with us. They were the big trampolines had just come out, so the kids played on them with their kids for about 2 hours, and we had to leave, but we got in touch with each other, so we decided that we'd at least send Christmas cards and so on. And so we did. We hadn't saw each other for, oh, I don't know, 5 or 6 years. The kids were growing anyway. And so we were coming down, and we were going to St. Francis this time. And this wasn't the highway that Keith was on, but Kenny said, why don't we stop and call Keith and just see how they are, if he's there. So he did. He called, and Keith was really excited. He said, you come up, and he says, I'll buy you the biggest steak in Colorado. So we went up, and we got there probably in the middle of the afternoon. And for dinner, we went down to this place, and nearest this little town could have as a nightclub. But you could tell that Keith and Glenneth had been in there a lot, because when we went in, Keith went back and talked to the cook what he wanted. And so, and there was a band there, but I don't think Kenny and I might have danced the last dance, but it was more or less getting acquainted. And in the time that we hadn't seen him, Keith had started working for the oil in the oil fields, and he was climbing the tower, and I don't remember whether a step broke or came loose or twisted, but anyhow, he had a fall, and he was hurt. He was hurt bad, and I don't know how long it took him to recuperate, but anyway, he was telling us about this, and he said, one day he was going through the mail, and he said, these letters you get, let's see, you know, you win so much money and so on. He just threw it across the table at Gwyneth, and he said, that'd be nice. Now, why this letter was ever sent just by the plain mail, I don't know. But anyhow, she said, I picked it up and looked at it, and she said, Keith, I think this is a real thing. And he said, what do you mean? She says, I think this is the real thing. She said, it's got the name of that oil company and everything on it. And they opened it up, and I don't know how many $100,000 that check was worth. It might have been $500,000, maybe more. But anyhow, she said, I think you better take this to the bank and see if it's real, and so we decide what you want to do with it. And so she said, and if it's real, she said, you've been wanting to trade your old pickup off. Why, get you a new pickup. So the next day, Keith said, I went to the bank, and I just knew they were going to say, you know, it's just an advertisement. Well, it happened to be the real thing. And so when Keith came home, Gwen said, when he came home driving a secondhand pickup. She said, why didn't you buy a new one? Well, he said, I like this one. And he said, I did buy a new pair of boots. And that was how he started his he had been doing cattle and so on. And after his fall, why, he said he went into the hog business. He could do that. He wasn't crippled or anything, but he just didn't have the strength that he did before. And he said, I just kept right on doing it. And anyhow, we stayed there, and like I say, we went down to this dinner. And after that, if we would go back to Kansas that way, first we'd stop at Keith's, and if we'd known somebody that'd been deep sea fishing, why, we'd take him a salmon. Always took him walnuts and filberts. And so we started stopping up there, and even when Mother went with us, and we went to this one place, and there used to be a filling station, but they changed it into a, I guess, a steakhouse. And they said they had the best food from Denver to Kansas City. And so each time he'd take us up there. Well, they had been up there a lot because they knew all the waitresses and everything. And when we went up there, why, Gwyneth would do the ordering. She'd go back and tell them, and they had a chef there, tell them what we wanted. And you could order just about anything you wanted. And it was right on the Colorado-Nebraska line, and there was nothing for miles each way, except just down the road a little ways was a filling station. So after that, this was one of our main stops, was to see them, and we did this for several years. And after that, why, we came, Mother came home with us, especially she kind of did things like Kenny's mother did after he passed away. Why, Mother would come and stay at least four, sometimes 6 weeks in the summer. And one place we took her was to this vortex. And if you haven't seen that, it just looks like, I call it a shed, slid down kind of either a hill or I guess it'd be a hill, and when it come on flat land, it just sat there, all weather beaten and everything. And we had been there with the kids. I'd been there before. And when you drive in the parking lot, it's okay. But when you get out and go in the lobby, it's okay. But you open the door and things change. I mean, a broom will stand by itself, and golf balls and marbles will roll up a slant instead of down a slant. And if you go to walk across to the other end of this building, why, you really get dizzy. And I couldn't walk across by myself. Kenny and the kids did, but I couldn't. The time Mother went, she did, but I couldn't. It was as bad as the funhouse in Denver, where the barrels went one way and they went the other way. When you go outside of this and you go around on one side of this building, there's a kind of like a clothesline. And you stand on one end of it, and then there's this line, and somebody stands on the other. Well, Kenny's about almost 6 inches taller than I am. And when we stood looking at each other, it was like you were just looking straight across. And we changed ends. And, of course, I was on the short side that time. And that side looked like it was the same height that way. Another thing, they said no wild animals ever cross this. Now, how big an area it is, I really don't know. But no wild animals will go there. Horses won't go there. And they said when the Indians lived there, this was one place that they wouldn't go. There was, and if a airplane flew over, why, their instruments went crazy. But anyway, we took Mother down there, and I think Sages might have been with us that time. And we went on down to Wildlife Safari. She'd never ever been there. And we might have had Jennifer and Danielle with us. I know we had Danielle because she rode on an elephant. And we camped out down that way. Another thing Mother said that she'd never done was go deep sea fishing. Well, the fellow that Kenny and Emil had built a house for, Ralph Cole, he had a cabin cruiser, pretty nice boat. And so Emil said, well, I'll talk to Ralph and we'll set up a time to go. And so we went over, and I think maybe Larry Stratton went with him. Anyhow, Mother and Kenny and Emil and Larry, and then this was a pretty big cruiser, and Ralph took him out. And I didn't go. I either had some A&S work to do or something. Anyway, I didn't go. And so when Mother got back, she said, well, she said, I went fishing and I didn't even get sick. Well, Kenny said, when they went over the bar, she did get a little bit sick, but she never ever would admit that she got sick. And talking about going deep sea fishing, another trip we went over there, why, Elmer Kirkendall lived over there, and he was one that I might have mentioned before. He was Uncle Glenn's brother-in-law, and he and Dad were on the same ball team when they were playing ball years before. But anyhow, they decided they'd go fishing. And for some reason, I spent the afternoon with Emil and Viola, and I think we were just over there in the car at that time. Anyhow, the three of them went out, and they just got out in the bay, and the motor died on his boat. Now his boat was just a plain fishing boat. And Uncle Glenn had forgot to put the anchor in. Now, whether that made any difference, I doubt it. But anyway, he started working on it, and Kenny started waving his jacket because they went underneath the lifeguard station. And they just went under it and started drifting south, and there was warnings on a loud blowhorn of some kind that, you know, all ordering all boats in and not letting any come out because there was a big storm coming, and the wind was blowing pretty good then. Well, they, instead of going north like most of them did, the wind sent them south. And I was sitting with Emil and Viola in the dock, and these boats kept coming in, and oh, after an hour, I told Emil, I said, they should have been in by now. Oh, he didn't know. So I kept telling him, I said, I think something's wrong because they should have been in by now. So he went over and told the lifeguard that there was a boat out there. Boy, that boat took out right now, really fast. But instead of going south, it went north. And it made two or three big circles. Well, in the meantime, they kept drifting farther down. And any boat or any sign of a boat or anything, Kenny would be waving a life jacket, and Elmer would be working on the boat, and Glenn was seasick, but he didn't care. He didn't care what happened. Well, anyhow, the wind kept coming up and coming up, and finally Kenny said, Elmer just gave up. He said, in about 45 minutes to an hour, he said, the way we're drifting, we'll hit the bar in those waves. And he said, this boat will either fill with water or it'll break in half. It won't stand the waves that are going to come in with that bar when they go over the bar. So Kenny, I guess, kept waving the boat, or waving the jacket. Elmer was just sitting in the boat, this lifeguard boat kept sailing down. And of course, Kenny said, I started waving more and more and more. And And he said that they could see this boat coming, and then it turned around and started back up. And then they said, Elmer really did give up. You know, this is it. Well, evidently, anybody in this boat, well, it was a lifeboat, said, I think I saw something. So they made another cruise, and they went down and picked him up. And when they got down there, why, the fellow in charge on that boat, he was really put out at him. He said, didn't you know that there was warnings for this boat? And they said, well, they had drifted right under the lifeguard, or the life, what would I say? Well, anyway, right under where there was supposed to be 24-hour watch, and the motor wasn't running then. And so he said, we'll get you guys in, but we can't promise we'll get your boat in. And Kenny said that boat was just bouncing around like a cork. That it'd go way up beside him, and then it'd go way back, way up beside him, and we got back. Well, they got in, and they got the boat in. And the Coast Guard picked him up and talked to him. And the next morning, over the news, it said three of them were rescued by the Coast Guard, but it didn't mention that they'd went right under the Coast Guard's watchtower, and that that's supposed to be watched, I guess, all the time for 24 hours a day. But anyhow, they did get in. And when Mother was here and Dad was alive, well, we'd go up and see the two aunts in Salem and so on. Well, after Dad passed away, when Mother was here, we'd go up and see Miney and her cousin Flora, and then they'd come down. And she'd also see I always said eight cousins, but there were nine of them. I don't know which ones I forgot. But anyway, she'd see them. Well, the cousins had got together, and the Orville, Elmer's daughter, she lived on the coast and had her own fishing boat, and she didn't get to see the cousins often enough, so they decided we'd have a reunion once a year. And the first one was at Norman's, and he put some kind of a roast on a barbecue, and that thing, he must have roasted it for on a barbecue for hours and hours and hours. Well, anyway, there was between, 35 people maybe there, and we decided, well, hey, this is too big for just to be at a house. Well, I will do it at some kind of a campground. And so when Aunt Laura Bell come over, they tried to find a place that was kind of so each one of them wouldn't have to drive so far. And I think the first one they had was at down here at Curtin. And anybody went to these, in-law cousins were bear hunters and so on. And when they'd show up, they'd wear the big black hats and they'd bring their dogs. And kind of everything went at these. I'll kind of skip around to tell you about them. First, I'll do the food. Those of us that had RVs or so on didn't have any trouble with ice, but several of them came in tents. And so one of the cousins, he made a box about a foot deep and maybe 4 foot long. And he insulated it, and put chipped ice in there, so those that didn't have a an RV for with a refrigerator could put their food in there, and it was packed. And really, I don't think you can mention any kind of food that didn't have it, because like when Laura Bell came, she brought anything from the coast, from salmon to clams to oysters. And the rest of us, I imagine there was, well, there were them 9 kids, and two of them had passed away, but their families came, and then Joyce and us, and all told, I imagine there was close to, oh, between 30 and 40 people at each one of them. And then when Mother was here, she went, and they always had the barbecue, and they started getting arriving at Thursday, and then Friday morning, well, they'd set up camp and start a bonfire. We could usually always have a bonfire, and they would no more get those up than somebody would have. There'd be two or three guitars, and there would be music, and also a pinochle game would be started right away. And they didn't forget the kids. There was and Danielle went with us partnered every time, and she really liked to go, because there was, oh, I don't know, 5 or 6 little girls about her age, and Jennifer went with us a couple or three times. And we'd take this makeup that we hadn't used, or any used makeup or dress-ups. Those kids would spend hours playing beauty shop and dress up and so on. Well, one day they were playing, and this little girl was crying. It was Ronnie, and he was a pretty big guy, and he went over to see what was the matter. And she said, well, her dad wouldn't let her put any makeup on because it wasn't good for her face. And he said, well, does it hurt your face or break out or anything? She said, no, but he just said, I'm too little to put makeup on. So Ron went over to his daughter-in-law or son-in-law, and he said, how come she can't put use any of the makeup? Well, it's not good for her face. He said, she don't need to do it anyway. And he said, well, he said, you think that that makeup would hurt her any worse than them tears? Well, he said, she don't need to play it. We were all sitting close enough that we could hear all this. And Ron said, and this, her dad, he was one of the ones to first to play pinochle, and he was always first in the evening, because they had pinochle games all evening until wee hours of the morning. And he was always first. And Ron said, well, he said, I tell you what, he said, tonight, when they start playing cards, you may feel like tears feel like, because you won't be playing. And that was all that was said. He went over and sat down. Well, I think he knew his father-in-law, because it wasn't very long till the little girl was over there playing. And then they always had some kind of games for the kids. The boys would play ball or jacks or anything. They had all kinds of things. And then one of the mothers had fixed some kind of a, I think it was just kind of like a sheet maybe, and on two poles. And they brought all kinds of stuff, and they had a fish pond. And the kids would throw their fish hook over, and they always get some kind of a toys. And like I said, anything you might see went on. One time, these bear hunters, they treed a bear one night just as it was getting dark. So everybody, Mother and I didn't, but all the rest of them went down to see this bear they trimmed. And I never did see any guns there, but I did see clubs. And I don't know what they did with the bear. They never ever caught it or anything. And Another time, the dog had puppies down there once, and another time there were some of them was holding their breath that there wasn't a baby born down there, but that never ever happened, which I'm kind of surprised. At one time they had an auction. Anybody that brought any white elephant, they brought it, and they brought enough to pay for the entry fee for everybody there. I mean, their entry rate, so, I mean, you know, 40 people, and they bring all kinds of stuff. Dad, he never was alive to go into any of them, but mother was here for lots of them. One time she cut hair. She cut all the kids wanted hairs, and there was 3 to 4 generations of people there, so, like, most anything that anyone knew
went on.
Never ever did get very loud. Those of us that thought so, anyway. But when we were down here at this one place, why, the caretaker come by and he said, "There's a curfew here." Why, he said, "You'll have to tell them. You'll have to quiet down." And so Ronnie said, "I'll tell him." Well, I don't know whether he did or not, but about an hour later, the guy came back again, and he says, "I told you that, you know, you're going to have to tell him to quiet down." And Ronnie said, "I told him." Well, that was one time these guys were there with their dogs and so on. The caretaker never came back. But we were the only one at that end of the park anyway, so it didn't really, you know, make that much difference. What did you do next? Oh, this was about in 91, why Paul and Mardell wanted us to go on a trip to Canada, to Alaska with them. So we arranged to go, and we drove to Portland and left the car there, and we flew to Anchorage. Well, right before we got into land, I don't know how far out we were, but anyhow, all four of us had a glass of wine, and I guess all four of us must have went to sleep. Anyhow, Kenny got sick, and he didn't know it, and when we woke up, why, he had vomited some, and I asked the steward, stewardess for a towel, and I think she probably thought, well, he got sick drinking that glass of wine, and she just threw it at us like that. And so when they landed, why, he said, "I just don't feel very good." And so when we got out and we started across to the terminal, there was a lady there, and she had lived in California before and moved up to Anchorage, and she liked to come in and watch the planes land. Or they had, I guess you'd call them planes that were there, and if anybody got sick out in the bush or something, they'd go out and fly them into the hospital there. So anyhow, when she saw Kenny was having trouble walking across to the terminal, why, she called the paramedics, and they come out, and he when they got there, he was sitting in the chair, and they took one look at him, and they said, "You know, you better get to the hospital." So there was a Catholic hospital right close there, and Paul Mardell said, "Well, we'll get all the luggage and bring it over." Now, how, whether they got a taxi or whether there was a bus or something took them back and forth, I don't know. But anyhow, we went on. They got him in the hospital, and it was kind of different when we got there. Like I say, it was a Catholic hospital, and she was a nun, but I think she also maybe been head nurse or something there, because she was giving everybody orders. And there was a little Catholic priest. He was a little Frenchman, and I don't imagine he was over 5 feet tall. Well, when they had him in this, I guess it was an examination room, you'd call it, where they were put, the doctor's nurse was putting nurses in there, and she was right there at the foot of the table or bed they had him on. And here was this little Catholic priest. He was in getting the last rites, and all these hands were in there. I don't know how they knew what was what. But anyway, she came over and she said, and sat down by me. She said, he's gonna be here a while. And she said, tomorrow I'll take you down to the McDonald house, and you can stay there. But she said, it's too late to do that today. But she said, the priest's office is just down a little ways. And she said, he's got a cot in there, and you can sleep in his cot. And I said, well, I'll probably just stay in Kitty's room all night. She said, well, you can feel free to go down there. Well, in the meantime, why, Paul and Mallard Dale shows up with all this luggage, and they bring it in, and she orders them to take it and store it. I don't know where they took it, but anyway, they took it, and she told me, she said, when he gets put in a room, why, we'll bring it up there. And she said, he'll be going to a room pretty soon, because she says, he's all right. Well, Paul and Mardell didn't want to leave me up there, and they didn't know how Kenny was, and yet, and there was only about 2 or 3 hours till the cruise ship that we was to get on would be leaving. And by this time, Kenny probably was in his room by that time. And so first they were going to stay, and Kenny said, no, you go on to your trip. There's nothing you can do anyway. And we're not going anywhere for a while. So, and he said, besides that, he said, when you get to Portland, I want you to drive the car down to our place, and then you can stay all night before you go home. And Paul said, oh, no. He said, that's just a new car. You just got it. He said, I wouldn't drive it. And Kenny said, well, you got to drive it. He said, how else are we going to get that car home? Because he said, when I'm able to fly, we'll just fly straight into Eugene. So they did. They agreed to leave, but they really hated it. And I probably stayed in the room with Kenny till the wee hours. But you know, whenever it did get dark, it just kind of got like a twilight, and it never did get up there. And that McDonald house, it was really, really something. And like I say, the nuns took me over and introduced me to the people kind of in charge there. And she said, I'll be seeing you. Well, they told me, they said, there's always something to eat here. He said, if there's restaurants to bring things over, or if there's some committee or somebody that's had a big dinner and there's food left over, or prepared, they bring it over. And the only thing is if somebody goes to downtown and brings something back and puts their name on it in the refrigerator, why, we respect that. But, oh, they had shelves of all kinds of cereal, and I don't know how many refrigerators they had. And people in there were really, really friendly. There was one lady that she was pregnant, and she lived out, what they called, out in the bush. But she was having problems, so she just come and stayed at McDonald's house. And if she needed to go in the hospital, she'd be there. And on the weekend, why, her husband had come. And she just stayed there. They never charged you a dime. They never asked for anything. And they said, if you ever go downtown or bring anything back and want to share it, that's fine. Or if you don't, why, just write your name on it. And she said, anytime, a night or a day, there's always something to eat. If you come back from the hospital, at midnight, but you can come in or turn on the light and get something to eat. And she said, we've got a roommate from you. And this lady, I don't remember her name, but she was an Eskimo. And she told me a lot of things. She had enough Indian blood that she got, I think she got half of what they pay them, so on. And her husband, he was full Indian or Eskimo or whatever. And he got this, and I don't know why. I guess he was in the hospital because she was my roommate. And the lady that had called the paramedics, she came up to see Kenny. I don't know whether it was the next day. Anyway, she came up to see how he was and come in to see us. And she asked me, she said, would you like to go out and see one of the volcanoes? And I guess it was supposed to be a famous volcano. And I said, oh, I don't know whether I really want to, you know, leave the hospital. And Kenny said, well, go ahead and go. He said, I'm not going anywhere, and some of us ought to see something about Alaska, because all he could see was these airplanes that would come in and land, and that where they landed was just, he could hear those planes come in, and he could see the, out the window where they take them in. And that's all of Alaska that he saw while he was there. But anyhow, this lady had been formerly from California. Of course, she wanted to know all about Oregon and California. It was about, I suppose maybe we were gone 2.5 hours. And she took me out to see this volcano. And I was really disappointed. I don't know what I thought I'd see. But this volcano, to me, just looked like a huge, huge, I don't know, icicle. Well, it wasn't an icicle. It was more like just a pile of ice, and it had dirt in it. And she told me that during the years it had melted and just rescinded back in. And I guess you could take ship rides or boat rides if you wanted to and go out around it. It was kind of, there was water around it, but I don't think it was deep enough for a boat anyway. I wasn't going out there. And so we sat there, and like I say, I was kind of disappointed in it and didn't think that I don't know what I thought I'd see when I got out there. I guess I thought, I think the mud and dirt in it, and it looked like dirt. I suppose it was real mud. But anyway, we got back to the hospital, and she came up and saw Kenny 2 or 3 times. And when he first went in the hospital, he had a angioplasty. And I don't really know what an angioplasty is, but I do know that the male nurse that put the bandage or that wrapped it and so on, he put it on so tight that you could, I'm sure, spend a coin on it. And but they said that he would need something done to his heart, and I don't remember the details, but anyhow, I called the kids, and Nancy and Bill flew up, but they didn't get there till after he was to have his surgery. Well, the doctor came in the night before and went through it all, and he said, we can do this heart surgery. Or he said, did you ever think of an angioplasty? Did I say angioplasty before? It was angiogram first, the one they did. Okay, then they did an angioplasty, I guess. Well, of course, I don't know what either one of them really are. But anyhow, he came in, he said, did you ever think about that? Well, we'd never even heard of it. And he said, I could do an angioplasty. And he said, you wouldn't do the surgery. He said, I could do it with that. He said, but it's up to you. But he says, I'm good. I'm damn good at doing them. So, well, right away, we thought, hey, that sounds a lot better than a heart surgery. So the next morning, he said, I'll do that, and I'll see that you're all right, and then I'm going on vacation. Well, so the next morning, I don't remember seeing them do the angioplasty, but I was in there right afterwards because they had what they called a traveling nurse. And she came in and did the wrapping and put the tape and so on him. Well, at the time, it went through my head, she's sure not getting those as tight as that male nurse did. But I said, surely, you know, I thought, surely she knows what she's doing. Well, he went to sleep right after she got through it, and I decided I just walked down the hall a little ways. And I wasn't gone any time at all, thank goodness. And when I came back in, I looked in there, and there was blood everywhere. It is all over his bed, and it sank down to his mattress. And I went to the door right quick, and the nurse's station was right close, and I yelled at a nurse. I said, there's blood everywhere in here. And boy, they just come running. And a nurse came in right away, and there was two of them come in, and the one that was always bossing and so on, the nun, she didn't come. But when they got that through, why, Kenny had turned really, really pale. And I don't know how much blood that he'd lost. His doctor had gone. So they got another doctor to come in there, and he told him, he said, you can either have a blood transfusion or you can make your own blood. Well, that time there was a scare on about blood. And so he said, well, I'll make my own. Well, we should have had Mike come up because he was stationed in California, I think, at the time. And he's the same blood type as his dad. So it would have worked out fine, but he didn't. And by that time, Nancy and Bill had got up there for two or three days. And I don't remember just how long that he stayed before he got to come home. But the night before, and Bill and Nancy and I shared a room, and I don't know where they put Bill. But anyhow, the night before we were to fly out, why, they put us all, Kenny came over and he was in a bed by himself, and Nancy and I shared a bed. They had a cot bed put at the foot of Nancy's on our bed. And we felt kicking. I said, Bill, quit kicking our bed. Everybody was in a good mood because we were going home. And I said, quit kicking this bed. He said, I'm not kicking your bed. And I said, well, something's kicking it. And I turned on the light, and it was a light that hung down from the head of the bed a little bit. It was going like that. And Kenny said, I bet it's an earthquake. Well, sure enough, the next morning, it had been an earthquake, but it hadn't done too much damage, except it hit the airport pretty heavy and tore up the runways. So we didn't know whether we were going to get to come home or not, but we'd heard that there was one runway open. And I can't remember how we got to the airport, but we did. And we flew out. We finally flew home. And Paul and Mardell had stopped at Portland, got the car, drove it down, stayed all day. We'll stop talking about traveling for a little bit. In 1994, Emil and Viola had their 50th anniversary. And it was over at the Eugene Moose Lodge. And it was nice, and quite a few people came there. Okay, then in 1996, it was our turn. And I had a friend, Bonnie Lottie, and she said, you got a lot on you're going to have a lot to do. She said, well, how about me being your decorator? And I said, Amos didn't have any decorations. She said, I don't care what Amos had. She said, I'd just like to decorate. And I said, okay, fine by me. So I don't know. Kenny went over and talked to the administrator at the Springfield Moose, and at that time we belonged to the Eugene Moose, and they said, yeah, we will. And Kenny said, well, you know, what are the charges? And he said, you're a Moose member, there won't be any charges. And Kenny said, oh, I'll donate, I'll give you $100. Well, he said, you know, we won't turn it down. So anyhow, the administrator and was kind of in on the plans. And so Bonnie, she decorated, and she had, there must have been at least 20 tables around. She had white tablecloths on all of them. And she'd ordered heart-shaped helium balloons we filled with helium gas. And they must have been, the hearts were probably that big. And she had them tied with a ribbon. And I don't know how she anchored them down, whether I suppose rocks or something. Anyhow, they were in a basket. Well, somebody else said, I want to get in on the act. So she bought candles. They were so big like that, that they were wax candles. She said, now we can have a candlelight dinner. Well, so they had those on the table. Well, Nancy and I had gone up to the, and it was catered. I picked out the stuff we wanted. And Kenny said, I want chocolate-covered strawberries. I don't know whether he ever had one or whether he ever got to eat them or not. And Linda kept the guestbook as they come in. They brought in a portable bar, and Steve kind of tended to that. That was an important job, especially to him, because if you weren't a Moose member, you couldn't buy anything. You had to have a Moose member buy it for you. So there were, had a sticker posted on Moose like that, so you could come in. And Steve was back there at this counter. Well, Kenny had bought ordered a cake of a beer. Of course, they had other drinks too. And Bill, I don't know where he got it, someplace in Eugene, some kind of they didn't need a disc jockey. They kind of did. I don't remember how the music was. But anyhow, there was all 40s and 50s mostly. And then Bill's friend, Kevin Kirby, he was more or less at Elvis Presley in impersonator. In fact, has he been to Grand Ole Opry and tried out and so on. So he said, kind of at intermission, would you get up and perform for us? And oh, of course, that time, why? Oh, yeah, I'll do that. So we were just kind of getting it all set up as things went. And one thing, there was lots of surprises happened. Bill Randall, who we hadn't saw for a while, I don't know how they done it, fixed it up with the kids that he'd come in the middle of the afternoon. They met him at the airport. The middle of the afternoon, he walked in. Well, then Bob Days, he came in, and he had brought, he fixed it on a poster so big, like this. And I think they were Susan B. Anthony, $50. And he'd made a 50. Well, we put on all the invitations, no guests and so on. But this was no surprise for Bob. So anyhow, we had that dinner and so on fixed. Well, then Gary Hall and Ruth were close friends, and she did an act like a bag lady. And Gary said, Would you like Ruth to come in and do a little surprise, be the bag lady? Well, Kenny and I had seen it, but I don't think any other person there had ever seen it before. And yeah, this would be fun. And we never told anybody. We never told the kids. But Kenny went over and had it okayed with the administrator. Except there was only one mistake. He didn't tell anybody, and he was gone. And so I guess we decided we'd eat. I think we went over about 5 o'clock when we decided we'd eat about 7. And they thought Beth had her candles there. She thought we'd have a candlelight dinner. Well, there was between 175 and 200 people there. And they turned out all the lights, all the candles were there, but they did not light up enough, so we had to turn the candles back on. Well, anyhow, after they ate and the music started playing, and I don't know, I suppose it was about 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock. There was all this commotion out in the entryway, and in come the bag lady, and she looked like a bag lady. I mean, hair straggling, blacked out teeth, swinging a whiskey bottle like this. And she came up in the front, and it just got deathly quiet in there because nobody knew it. And the kids, you know, they didn't know what to think about it. And Kenny and I and Gary were saying, and she said, "I hear there's a party here, and I wasn't invited, but I come anyway." Well, the governor, he thought it was for real. He was stepping over, and he tried to throw her out. And he did get a little bit rough, and yet he said, "Slow it down. Don't be, you know, it's all right. It's all right." She says, "Where's Richie Charbonneau?" And she wanted to list the names that she could go to. I said, "Richie Charbonneau's for one." She said, "Where's Richie Charbonneau?" She said, "He's a good cop. He likes me." He said, "I know Sherry. Or I know Richie. He'll let me stay." And well, Richie had left about 10 minutes before. "Well, where's his dad?" He said, "He used to be a cop." So and Kenny said, "Dick, come up here." So Dick come up here, and the governor, he was back here, and the kids were just all around. And I'll always remember there was Paul and Aaron and Ryan. They were really up close to her. And I said, "You guys stay back just a little bit." And he come up, and she says, "I know Richie, and he'd let me stay. And you were a cop. I can stay, can't I?" And, oh, I don't know, Dick was joking with her. And she said, "Well, sit down." And then she says, "Where's Bill Randall?" He was sitting over there. He looked, she said, "I want to dance with you." Well, he's crippled. He said, "I can't dance." He said, "That's all right. I'll come over and sit with you." He said, "All right, you can come sit with me." And pretty soon she looked at all the kids and she said, "All you kids get in a line up there." And then she took Kenny and I back and she said, "You sit over here." Well, mother and her aunt from Salem and all them were sitting back here. And everybody else was still, you know, kind of wondering about her. And what's that macaroni dance or whatever, I don't know what it's called, but where you touch your head, you do all this stuff and so on. Anyway, she started singing that and doing that. Well, Elise wasn't 2 years old yet. She was just, she wasn't 2 years old, and Pat was holding her. And she kept squirming, trying to get down, so Pat put her down. And she went back and stood right by Ruth. And Ruth swears to this day she stole my show, because everything Ruth would do, the motions, Elisa would do it. And this went on for quite a little bit. And then she said, "Okay, everybody that wants to do this, we're going to do another. Anybody that wants to could get out. We're going to put your little toe in." And so she had him do that. And There, a bunch of the younger kids got out and done that. Pretty soon she said, well, I guess she would over put her arm around Bill. She said, well, I guess I'll have to leave. And so she went a swinging her bottle out and she laughed. Well, for a long time, nobody knew who it really was. So then they played music and they came at, oh, I don't know, I suppose about 11, stopped for an intermission. Of course, there was people talking all over that hadn't seen each other forever, and like 175 plus people there. And they said that, I guess, oh, no, it's the Elvis Presley would come. So Darren got up and he sang and danced three or four times. And oh boy, he went over big. So he went back and sat down. And so then they wheeled out, I think we had three cakes. So they did the cut the cakes and had cakes. And I forgot to tell you, Bob went over in the afternoon and him and Bonnie fixed it. A special table back there, and he propped up. He's 50 plus, and I don't know, that some heart balloons and some sparklers that kept going on and off. I don't. I guess they were electric or something. I don't know. Anyway, there was so much going on that just didn't make it. Anyway, after they had the cake, I don't know. I think they probably went till about 1:30, and the lodge usually closed at 1, and it was after that, was almost 3 o'clock before we got home. And then there was, where's everybody going to sleep? Well, Mother, she had one room down here already because she'd been out here all summer. And Linda and Steve went upstairs. Bob said, I get the motor home, and I think Bill Randall went out to the motor home. And of course, Bill Randall, he sat up till, I don't know, quite late. And the next morning, why, Bob and I got up and we go to church. The only thing they took out of there that night was the $50 sign. And Frank and Judy and Sean, they got motel rooms, and Betty and Ron did. And who else was out here? The ones from Salem, they all did. And Shirley was there, and Joyce and Alan. Alan left, but Joyce stayed. And one of the twins went, and he told him the next day, he said, I think we'll find more about Mom's side of the family than Dad's all the time. But anyway, the next morning, Bob and I got up and went to church, and then we went straight on over to the lodge to start help and put stuff away to get it cleaned up. And some of them, there was in the bar, come up and help start folding up chairs and putting them away. And that cake was back there. There were several from that come in for breakfast that hadn't been there the night before. So they come in and had cake, and we had a lot of cake left, but very little food left, just a little bit. They ran out of quite a bit of stuff. And anyway, all the cousins from Salem come, and Ron, I don't know, there was a whole bunch of them come over. They had that room cleaned all up and no time of flat. Of course, Bob and I, we took the credit. We were there to start with. And Bill had to take the musical instruments back. Well, instead of going home, the ones from Salem, they came back. And we didn't have the deck. We just had the plain patio back there. So the ones from Salem were here, and the ones from Portland were here, and they were here all afternoon. And so we got counting in there was people from, I think probably Frank and Judy might have came the farthest because they were from Missouri, St. Louis, Missouri. But there was from Missouri and Colorado and Kansas, Colorado and California and Washington, Oregon. There was a lot. And so we had a good time.
I keep a close watch on this heart of mine. I keep my eyes wide open all the time. I keep the ends out for the tie that binds. Because you're mine, I walk the line.